technical difficulties, and hopefully you can learn how to hustle in today's event. So joining us today, we have a wonderful and diverse range of panelists. I'm so excited to share all of their experiences with you. Again, my name is Ahana, but you know, it's not that important, but I'm going to go ahead and popcorn off to Jira. And Jira, if you could go ahead and introduce yourself and your business to the rest of the panelists and the attendees. And then after you're done, you can just go ahead and popcorn off to the next panelist and we'll just continue on like that.
Okay. Well, hello everyone. And thank you for the invitation. I'm loving this. I love the idea. My name is Jira Stewart and I have a bakery called Jira's in the Fifth Third Bank building on Summit, 550 North Summit. We're down in the lower level. People always say, where are you? We can't find you. Well, we're inside of the bank building, so in the lower level and right next to the Imagination Station. And we specialize in doing baked goods from scratch. Very few people are doing that anymore. We actually get the butter, the sugar, the eggs, and we put it all together. We don't use mixes. We don't use cans of things. We use from scratch baking, old-fashioned baking, and have a wonderful staff of women that work with me right now, and we're having a jolly good time. And next one, anyone else, next person?
So you get to decide who's next.
Oh, gotcha. Well, so who is here? I have, you know, I got in late because I was trying to get the password and all of that. So I don't even know who all is here. Let me put my glasses on. Perhaps I can see something. Yeah. The young lady that won Jumpstart.
Oh,
tell me your name. Yes.
Zubeda.
Thank you. Say it again.
Zubeda.
Zubeda. Okay. Zubeda, you're next.
Thank you. And good to see you.
Good to see you.
So I am a social entrepreneur, and I am known for being the founder of Cure, which is a lifestyle black seed brand geared towards promoting health and wellness by innovating black seed consumer products. So we create superfood products and give back a percentage to those in need. Specifically, we donate our proceeds towards hunger relief programs. We'd love to focus on hunger relief. And so that is kind of our mission. And that's why we're called Cure, because not only are we creating healthy, nutritious products that are going to benefit your health, but also we hope to cure humanity by, you know, giving back to the less fortunate and promoting that in our business practices. Kind of a jack of all trades. I was in real estate before I launched Cure, and I was a teacher before that. I like to invest in the stock market. I'm on social media. I have different businesses through that. And I like to do all things. My passion is to help people. That is my number one passion. So anything that I do, I always try to make sure that that is involved in my business practices.
Excellent.
Popcorn. Okay, popcorn. Going to popcorn. Stephanie.
Thank you, Zubeda. My name is Stephanie Georgakopoulos. I'm with Primerica Financial Services. My location is in Maumee, out in the Arrowhead Business Park. Typically, I work with female business owners that are really focused on growing their business, and they don't really have that much time or energy to maximize and grow their wealth, and they're a little bit overwhelmed about that. So I help them, you know, put clarity and processes in place so that they can get back to doing what they do best, growing their business. In addition to that, I have a Pomeranian. His name is Achilles. He's the love of my life. And I am a member of a couple of different groups, like the Women of Toledo, the Junior League, and I'm also a Toastmaster. A little nutshell about me. I will popcorn. Lenora.
Hi, my name is Lenora McIntyre, and I am the owner of electrical contract and supply company. We are a union company. We were established in 2000, so we've been on the scene for a little while. We're in Toledo on Burn Street, and we specialize in commercial and industrial contracting. So that's like construction and plants, your factories. And then we also do supply electrical. We are a minority certified business, certified with the federal government in the 8A program. And my background originally was corporate accounting and payroll. And I worked in there for probably about 10 years. We started our business. And just recently, within the last 3 years, I've come aboard at University of Toledo, working with minority business development in the Minority Business Development Center. So on that note, I think I will popcorn Allison Dow.
Hi, sorry. I popped out for just a second to plug my phone in. I'm Allison Dow, and I own House of Dow, which is a vintage and resale shop downtown. And I also run an Airbnb in my home, which helps kind of supplement our business and keeps us going. A part of what we do at our shop that we don't really advertise is we provide free clothing for people in need in the community. So we also clothe homeless people, domestic violence victims, and LGBT people all for free. And it's an important part of our business for us to be involved in the community as well. So I'm really excited to meet some other involved business leaders as well. And I'm going to popcorn over to Stacy from Bucci Mama.
Thanks, Allison. And I just want to say thank you for having me. And it's a pleasure to be in this virtual room with all of these women. I can tell already that I'll take away some inspiration going forward. So my name is Stacy Jurich, and I am the founder of Bucci Mamas. And Bucci Mamas is a kombucha company. And I'm realizing that kombucha is still a new beverage to a lot of people. So kombucha, for those of you that don't know, is a fermented tea, and it's known for its probiotic health benefits. So when I first started Bucci Mamas, I was making kombucha at home, and it's a drink that really has roots, years ago as an East Asian natural ferment. And it recently in the 70s came to the United States. So it's still a fairly new health drink in the market. But I started out as a home brewer and started the business in 2015. We're located downtown on 10th Street. We have a small retail storefront. Currently we're only open 2 days a week because of COVID. Normally we're open at the retail store 4 days a week, but primarily the main part of the business is a wholesale. And we distribute to different restaurants, grocery stores, coffee shops around Toledo, Ann Arbor, Detroit, and Cleveland. And we, as a company, from the onset, have been very strong in our environmental sustainability goals. We have a bottle return program. Most of our waste is composted, and always looking for new ways to keep moving that forward. I think that might have been everyone.
That is everyone.
Thank you. Okay.
Well, we'll start off with you next. The next question, so you can popcorn someone then. So it's all fair and equal. But thank you guys so much for those introductions. I'm already super inspired. And I really appreciate how much you guys incorporate giving back to the community with your businesses. But with that, I think what a lot of us really want to know is what encouraged you to really get into this line of business, because everybody's business is so particular and pretty interesting. So what made you want to start Bucci Mamas?
Well, I'd just to sound like it was kind of like my backup plan, because it's turned out really well for me, but it kind of was. At the time, I was 30 when I started the business, and I'd spent the my 20s, I guess, working a variety of different jobs. I was a substitute teacher, a coach. I worked in different restaurants. And so I was kind of, at the time, applying for, instead of having three different jobs, I was kind of looking for one job to kind of start a career in. I wasn't getting hired because I didn't have any consistency in my resume. And so I was kind of like, well, I've got this thing going. You know, I was making kombucha and kind of selling it out of my home kitchen. And I had, through my travels, seen that in other cities, and particularly on the West Coast, kombucha was growing as a drink and as an industry. And there were a lot of, you know, besides the kind of national, larger scale brands, there were most cities had at least one or two regional kombucha makers, and they were doing really well. And so, you know, I guess one of the advantages you could say of being in Toledo and in the Midwest is we're a few years behind on a lot of trends. So I knew it was a matter of time before that health trend was kind of coming to the Midwest. So I just kind of pushed aside my fear of the red tape and what the obstacles of creating a licensed facility would look like, and what looking like, what are the bottling regulations. And that was a little intimidating at first, but, you know, I decided to go for it, and there was no turning back. Let's see, I will go down to Stephanie.
Thank you. The reason that I got into working with females in personal finance is a personal story. When I was 22, I was living with my adoptive mom and her significant other. They were together for 16 years and had a business together for 12. Well, I'm Greek, so the names are a little different, but one night, Kiriako, he had a heart attack, and we rushed him to the hospital. Thankfully, everything was okay from the heart attack, but when he was in the hospital, we found out that he had cancer. Mm-hmm. Due to the heart attack, he couldn't do any of the aggressive types of, like, you know, chemo, radiation, things like that, because his heart wouldn't handle that. And over the next 3 months, we were with him until he eventually passed away. Well, the day after he passed away, my mama, she got a phone call from his son from a previous marriage and said, in a nutshell, like, my dad behind your back went to businesses, the house, the bank accounts, all in my name. And so you're out. You don't have access to these things anymore, and you're on your own. So living through that experience with her of losing everything, it really made me very passionate about finding out what people know and what people don't. And statistically, educated on how finances work and what we should know and should be doing. 58% of women leave financial decisions a male relative, whether it's their father, their husband, their brothers, because they don't feel confident in making those types of decisions. So it became very important to me to go out and educate and motivate women to take control of that. Because at some point or another, we are going to be on our own, right? Even if we're happily married, we're going to outlive them, right? Worst rates at 50%. Things can happen. They could get into an accident at home. So it's very important for me help spread the word and empower them to know what's going on in their finances and be part of it. That is what encouraged me to start. Next, I will pick Allison. You're still muted.
I thought I was muted. Sorry. Thank you. My story is kind of similar to Stacy's. I worked at some other jobs that I didn't like and I didn't really fit in at. And I always bought and sold vintage stuff since I was a young kid, just to make extra money. And it was something that, I had seen in other cities. There's every major city you go to has a small vintage store of some kind. We just didn't have one here. So, I saw that it was something I could try and do bigger. And it was at a time when some of my friends were also leaving their jobs and looking for new opportunities. So I told them I thought that we could take the risk and open up a shop, and they helped me, and that was really it. And I got lucky that I'm still here. I'm gonna popcorn over to Zubeda, and thank you.
Sorry, I just had to unmute myself. Allison, I didn't know about your store, so I will be visiting you soon, hopefully. But what inspired me to start? I've always been interested in business. I was a little child hustler. My first experience with business, I'm just going to start there, is when I was in third grade and I sold pencils to my third grade class. My parents sent us overseas. We all went overseas to Jordan. They wanted to solidify our language in Arabic. So we studied for a year there when I was in third grade. And before we went, we bought all these school supplies and we went to Sam's Club, and my mom bought us these pencils with like the giant pumpkins or like little critters on them. If you guys remember those, like really big eraser. Yeah. And so took them to class, first day of class, all the students were amazed by my awesome pencil collection. And so this girl was like, I'll give you $5 for that pencil. And five Jordanian dollars is a lot more and stronger than just five American dollars. So I laughed and I was like, oh, I can't sell it for any less than 10. And she pulled out a $10 bill. I went to a private school. These kids were loaded. She gave me $10 Jordanian dollars for this pencil. And I learned the concept of supply and demand. And I thought it was so cool. And I ended up selling all my school supplies to my classroom. And I think, you know, at the age of 8, I made my first $1,000. And I just thought that was so cool. But really, I mean, Cure is way more than just selling pencils. It's like that combination of social need and market sustainable business practice. And so, you know, that came from always volunteering, always, my parents raised us to always look at those less fortunate than us. And that was just the way that I was brought up. And so I always wanted to create something that not only benefited myself, but also created long-lasting sustainability for others. And so I'm running out of time here, but I was inspired. My grandmother inspired the recipe, which made me create the Cure bars in my home kitchen. I started selling them. A video went viral. I'm giving you guys the SparkNotes version, and that kind of blew up the business. And I launched in 2016. I was 25. And yeah, we're still here. I am in my office right now. Here's my logo. And yes, I am going to popcorn Jera.
Oh, I am so impressed with all of your lives. Your background's amazing. I too have done a lot of different things in my life. But I started baking when I was 9. My mom let me into the kitchen the very first time on my own when I was about 9 years old. My dad loved baked goods. My mom loved to bake, and she had a joy for baking and always baked from scratch, always, always. And fast forward, and as I became a mother, wife and mother myself, I knew I wanted to stay home with my kids. I didn't want to send them other places while they were, before they went to school. So I stayed home with them, and people started telling me. I used to bake for schools and for church. If someone had a funeral, I would bake cakes, and people started saying, you need to sell this stuff. It's like, no, it's just, you know, it's just baked goods. It's not a big deal. But people seemed to be so impressed with the baked goods. Again, keep fast forwarding. I ended up starting a home-based bakery after people talked me into it. Like I said, it's always been a passion. And I started telling my kids when they were little, mommy's going to have a bakery one day. Mommy's going to have a bakery one day. And I knew that if I told them that, if I didn't do it, I would be a liar. So by telling them that, I was speaking it in faith that I'm going to have a bakery. I just knew and it wasn't just about the baked goods even. There's something about feeding people. There's something about them enjoying something that you make. And it's made, when people say things are made with love, there is a difference. There's a difference of something you go and buy at a big box store and something that somebody put together for you. And I just realized it's something much more to my business than just the baked goods. There's a relationship that happens when you are giving food to people, when you're selling food to people, or when we give a lot of our food away too, but there's something that happens. There's something, people tell you their life stories. They tell you about their mom who has cancer. They tell you, gosh, this tastes just like my grandmother used to make it. And they start crying sometimes. So there's so much more to the bakery than just the baked goods. But I started as a home-based bakery. I did that probably for about 10 years. And in 2017, had an opportunity to go into a brick and mortar and jumped on it. It's like, okay, this is it. This, my youngest child had graduated from high school. She was now in college, and it's time for me to launch and see what else can happen. And it's been great. And I give a lot of the glory to God. God has been phenomenal in my life with this business. And I'm in the process of looking for a new location. You're going to hear about me, and I'll send you all invitations to come to my new open house when I have it. It's just a good thing. And it's like I said, so much more than just baked goods, but that's part of it. It's good, healthy. I consider, even though they're sweet, if you eat in moderation, you're okay. Good, healthy baked goods they don't have a lot of extra junk in them, and they're made with love. And that's how I started. Buy popcorn too. I'm going to be using some of your businesses, by the way. Gosh, the contractor, I'm going to need you. I'm going to the contractor, Lenora. Was it Lenora? I'm popcorning to you, darling.
Okay. Thank you. Well, I can tell you, Jira, that I have sampled your delights, and I've even used you for an event that we had on campus. So please take advantage of me, because I have already thoroughly enjoyed your business wares. So, you know, they tell you sometimes that the best and most successful businesses are those that you have a passion for, you have extensive industry knowledge of, or you actually find a solution to a problem. Now, for our electrical contractor company, I could say there definitely was not a passion for it, but we got two out of the three checked off, because my husband and I have extensive background in electrical contracting. My husband was an electrical contractor and worked in that industry for over 17 years. So we felt like we really knew it. We knew the ins and outs. He was fairly young when he was given managerial positions to be in charge of crews of 20 to 30 people and jobs that were in excess of millions of dollars. And so we kind of learned together. We were newlywed. We kind of learned together. And we decided that there really was not a minority contractor in the game. It was big contractors, but there was not a minority contractor. So after doing some research and some soul searching, we decided that this is a niche that we could fill. So we started out our journey doing electrical construction. So we were in the GMs, we were doing industrial and commercial builds and rebuilds. But after a while we said, we don't want to do this forever. Not me, because I was kind of doing the books and the accounting, but he was doing the hard labor, and it's really tough on your body. So we said, how nice to be able to transition to something that won't be quite so labor intensive as we get older. And so we decided to become an electrical contractor supplier, and that has worked out really well. We have contracts across the nation, and we are expanding, especially with our certificates. We are certified as a government 8A contractor, and we also have MBE licenses in the state of Ohio. So that, coupled with the fact that when we started the business, we were in our 30s and I had just gotten pregnant. I think I was probably less than 6 weeks when we decided to start the business, and we found out the next day I was pregnant. And we all along wanted to leave something for our kids. But that kind of was the passion behind us starting the business, is that we wanted to leave a legacy for our children. So, you know, not knowing if they would want to follow in their mom and dad's steps, regardless, we wanted to leave them something. And I am happy to say that our son, who is 19, does work for the for our company. Now, we're also making him go to school and get his education, but he also works for the company and has started his own business. So I don't know, we just feel like it was a really big learning experience. And though there have been bumps and obstacles along the way, which we'll address later, I can say it has been a really good ride. And on that note, I think I was the last popcorn. So I
so you think get to start the next question. It's a great leeway into our next part. What obstacles have you faced?
Okay, I'm ready for this one. I'm gonna try to keep it to 2 minutes though, okay guys? Because it was a lot of obstacles. So this is what I really wanted to say. When I thought about this question, we had all the typical obstacles. We were minorities. We had issues with being viewed as equal to our contemporaries that were non-minority. We had issues with capital. You know, I can't tell you how many years we were trying to get our books cleared at the last day, December 31st, get everything in so we could close out QuickBooks, and the system crashed. We lost all our data. There was no backup. We've grappled with having too much work and not enough good employees and having the reverse. But I say for all of those obstacles, even though they bring a lot of heartache, you can kind of sit down and plan how to execute and take steps to correct those problems. And we did. But my biggest obstacles that I still grapple with are probably more internal than external. And it's twofold. One of them would be fear. Fear to make decisions, fear to look incompetent and to ask for help when you don't know what you're doing, and that people would look at me as a woman and not a business owner. And then the other obstacle was not knowing what I didn't know, because we found out the hard way that just because you don't know something doesn't mean that you're not liable and that there aren't consequences. And some of them are financial and some of them are very heavy. And so we've been hit with union violations and tax violations because we did not know. And so sometimes it can be really heavy to just wonder, okay, so what don't we know now? And how is it going to affect me? So I would say how we kind of combated those obstacles were a lot of prayer. We laughed together. And our biggest thing was reaching out to people that were smarter than us, that were already established in our industry, and we listened to what they had to say. And when they directed us to community resources, whether it be the MBAC program that I run or the business incubation program or the library, we listened. We listened and we availed ourselves of those resources. So that's got us through so far, and we're not there yet. So I'm hoping that it will carry us the rest of the way. Okay, so I think on that note, I will popcorn Allison.
I would say that the number one obstacle just towards being any kind of woman in business is being a woman. You're going to deal with sexist landlords, sexist people at the bank, especially the younger you are. I look pretty young for my age, and people often will come into my store and ask to see the manager or ask to speak to the owner to my face. I'll be out on a buy, you know, buying antiques or vintage stuff. And it was before the pandemic, but I'll occasionally drop a few hundred dollars at an antique sale on a buy. And I have more than once had a grown adult think that I couldn't pay, or that my partner was the person that they should be dealing with, even though I'm the one who controls all the finances. Especially when it comes to like negotiating for yourself and for your business's best interests, you're gonna run into people who think that you couldn't possibly have a clue, so they will try and take advantage of you, or they will just be outright rude. And the best thing you can do in that situation is just be strong and stand up to them, and also reach out to other people for help. One of the scariest parts of being a business owner, I think, is figuring out your taxes. And it's really easy to put off paying them or getting them figured out. And when you don't pay them right away, they get, it gets filed with the state that you haven't paid it yet. And there are all kinds of predatory legal agencies out there that will try and send you paperwork or call you and threaten you because you haven't paid your sales tax yet for last month. And it can be really intimidating to think that the government or a legal agency is out to get you for a bill of a few hundred dollars, and they'll threaten to take your business and they'll threaten your home. And really all you have to do is file some paperwork and pay $100. It took me until I talked to an accountant to know that. And when I met with an accountant, I felt 1,000 times better about being a business owner, because as a business owner, there's not a really, like, I didn't know what I was doing. I still don't know what I'm doing. And like one of the other women said, and I think it was Lenora, you have to reach out to other people who know better than you, and you have to be willing to admit that you don't know and that maybe you made a mistake. And that's a hard thing to do, but it's definitely the most important thing I think I've learned. And I recommend to everybody who is starting a business or has a small business they're operating on their own, talk to a tax expert or an accountant, have somebody who's proficient at doing online promotion, do your web stuff for you, get somebody else to help you make a website. You cannot do everything alone. And the more you try to do yourself, the more you exhaust yourself. And there will always be people out there who want to work for you as long as you're willing to give them the opportunity. And the more you're able to trust and delegate your work to other people, the more loyal they become because they know that you trust them as well. So I'm going to popcorn down to Stephanie.
Thank you, Allison. Well, something that I heard as recurring, and I think we might hear it from everyone, is definitely being a woman and that lack of respect. I have also had situations where somebody came in, I want to talk, you know, to the owner, and I'm, okay, I'm the owner, how can I help you? Are you serious? No, go get your dad. My dad is an electrical engineer and he lives in Greece. I don't know how he's going to help you with this issue, but okay, we'll go get my dad. So it can be very hurtful when people are dismissive of you. But you know, you just have to keep going, keep believing in yourself, overcoming that fear that I heard some of the other women talk about, fear of making a mistake, fear of you know, your pride kind of going down a little bit, like, oh yeah, maybe I don't know everything about everything. And that is absolutely okay. Nobody knows everything about everything. Go put yourself out there and learn and, you know, be better next time. And it's okay to make a mistake. Just don't hide from your mistake. Go out, tell your clients or whatever mistake you made, you know, like, I made this mistake, that these are the steps I'm going to make to fix it. And it will be okay. They'll appreciate that you came out and did that. Another obstacle that I faced personally was lack of support from family members. Through my passion, I told you a little bit about why I do it. It's very important for me. And in the beginning, when things were difficult and it was that lull before you get busy, I actually had my ex-husband, he didn't believe in me. We ended up getting a divorce because he wouldn't stand by me. But I know that there are a lot of people that are just, they're afraid, and they want to keep you in that safe space. And when you're trying to go for something a little bit better, a little bit greater, a little bit more, they try to hold you back, not necessarily out of malice, but it's just that it's out of their comfort zone, right? I had a great coach tell me with a rubber band, like, you got to get stretched. You got to, you know, stretch yourself outside of what you feel comfortable. And if you keep stretching that rubber band, you know, where it will open to keep getting farther and farther. And that has to be true for you as well, because the obstacles will come. You just have to keep going and keep pushing yourself to do and be better. So those are the obstacles that I can say I face. Then let's see. So the next person that I'm going to popcorn to, Stacey, have you gone for this question? No. Okay, for Stacey.
All right. So I had a baby in January. I took some time off. I have a great staff, and they were holding down the fort while I was on my maternity leave. But there was like, you know, the busybody in me was like, I gotta go work. Anyway, so I was going back to the shop, and I had my baby with me. And that day, our delivery van broke down for like the umpteenth time. And on the same afternoon, our walk-in cooler stopped working. So we had to move hundreds of cases of product. Thankfully, it was winter, into like this breezeway in our building that was hopefully going to like hold temperature. And it was like, I'm breastfeeding. I got this newborn baby with me, and just like 7,000 things happening all at once. And like, that's kind of what it is to run a business. It's like more often you're having that kind of a day. But it's really like, when I think of what it takes to run a business, you really are like on your creative problem solving skills and your solution skills. And it's like, there's obstacles, small or large or internal or external or logistical or like supply chain, or, I mean, it's just, it really is just kind of nonstop. And it's kind of our job as the business owner to like mitigate the results of those challenges and obstacles, and to make that, make the best out of the situation. And to run forward when you're going through a period of a flow, when you're not having those obstacles. I mean, there's, you know, nonstop obstacles when you're starting up, and they don't necessarily stop the further along in the business you're in. So that's my little story. And Zubeda, I think you're next.
Thank you. I think going off of what you just said, I think that ability to multitask is like your strongest asset when running a business, especially being a woman. I have two children. I have a 3-year-old and a 5-month-old, and that just added more to my plate. And so that being able to run the business and then, you know, deal with my marketing team, and COVID's actually kind of helped because everything is remote. And so Zoom meetings are the best. And you can just be in your sweatpants and run the business. And I'm currently in my sweatpants, but I dressed up on top for you guys. But so this is something that actually got me down a couple of weeks ago. I had like a little bit of a breakdown. Something went wrong, and I don't want to dwell on the problem, but I think for me, it's sometimes the customers, they don't appreciate the amount of work that goes into the products that people or entrepreneurs are creating for them. Like, they don't really realize that it's a work of art, because we as entrepreneurs, what we're doing is we are sacrificing time with our family, time with our family, especially during Corona time, but time that I could be doing so many other things. You know, I launched the business at 25. I was still young. I had so many other things I could have been doing, but instead I sacrificed that time to creating these products, which in the beginning, we're not really benefiting from. It's just like, we want to do this to put it out to the world to benefit other people. And then sometimes you get like really angry customers for absolutely no reason that will send you emails that really just get you down. And I'm the kind of person that if I have a customer who's not satisfied, who they're upset, it really weighs down on me. And I do everything in my power to make sure our customers are happy and, you know, our customer service is on point, I'm hoping. But yeah, when I get those kind of emails, and I got a really angry email, and it was because we were sold out of our popular roasted almonds and honey flavor, and we had back ordered them. And anyway, we were like 2 weeks late to delivering, and that was because we got delayed because of COVID. And anyway, I received a really angry email, and it super got me down. And I just wish that, I feel like that was one of my biggest obstacles. And it was that's my story. Has everybody gone?
I haven't.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Obstacles. Me. I think sometimes I'm my biggest obstacle. Not delegating, not trusting my staff enough, feeling like I have to be a part of all of it and I can't be. And several of you have said that you cannot do all of it. So I finally got an accountant. That was a big load off of me. Using the resources that are available. The Chamber of Commerce has, they are a cesspool. That's not probably a good word. I don't know. A big pool of people over there that can help you with legal issues, with contracts, with so many different things, rather than just taking them on yourself or trying to. And I don't understand a lot of those things. I just don't. What I understand is banking. I can do that all day and all night. I can do it in my sleep, but I can't do all of those other things. I can't be excellent at all those other things. And so to be able to let go and to be able to get enough people around you that you trust, that you can trust, so that you can let go, that you don't have to have your hands on anything, because you will exhaust yourself. You will kill yourself doing what you supposedly love. Some of the love goes out of it when you're so tired that you can't think straight, when you're so on edge because you feel like you have to be a part of this and a part of that, and you don't. And the bigger I get, the more I'm going to have to let go. Finding people who have the same kind of passion that I do. They may not have a passion for baking, but a passion to do well at whatever they are doing. That's one of my biggest obstacles, is finding those kind of people who take pride in what they do, who are excellent, who strive for excellence. I feel like I do that, and I want other people around me that do that the same thing. Then I can trust you. If I know that you're going to try to put this business, even though you're not going to have the same passion that I have for the business, but doing well at what you do. So obstacles are me learning to let go, finding the right people to undergird you and to work with you and to succeed with you, finding those right people, finding other people with a passion to do well at whatever they're doing. Time management. I don't have a lot of time to do the business part of it. So some of the business things get away from me. Some of the contacts that I need to make, those things get away from me because I am so busy doing the grunt work when I should have just delegated somebody else to do it rather than me trying to do it. I can't do it all. And that's what I think as women and as entrepreneurs, we have to remember that you cannot do it all. You can't do it all well. So being able to let go. And I think everyone has answered.
Everyone has answered. And I really wish we were all in a room right now so I could give everybody a hug. I just feel so uplifted hearing what everybody had to say. So
I was thinking the same thing.
Right?
Seeing it in person, I feel like this would be a really great group to keep. I don't know. I'm really feeling that too.
Yeah. I'm so happy. I think we're going to end the session with one piece of advice that you would give to another entrepreneur that might be starting out or wants to start out but is afraid to.
Fear has got to go. Step out there on faith. Trust you. Trust the power that's in you. That's it.
I would say make sure that you support your employees and they'll support you back. One of the most important things I think that I do for my employees is let them know that they can kick out or be rude to anybody who is rude or inappropriate to them, because our business is a safe space and I want them to always feel good about coming to work. And it makes them feel more loyal to the business, and it makes them care about showing up on time. And throughout the pandemic, my employees have had my back because we've had theirs. And I think that goes hand in hand with finding people who are just as passionate as you. You can find people who like the same thing as you, but if you can find people who have the same passion and drive about getting stuff done or just about succeeding, they'll be an asset to you. And I think that that's really the best thing you can look for when you're starting out.
Are we doing the popcorn?
We can, we're so close now, we don't have the popcorn. Whoever wants to go can go.
Okay, well, I'll go next then. My advice would be, don't be a perfectionist. Fail fast and fail forward. It's okay that something is not perfect. Just get it out there, learn from the market. They'll give you feedback of what you need to change. Don't get into the analysis paralysis like, oh, I have to make it perfect. And then a lot of the other panelists have mentioned, get help from professionals. You might think, I don't have the money to do this, but really you don't have the money not to do it. The cost of waiting or trying to do it yourself and learn all the things that professional knows to help you with will make up for itself. So don't be afraid to spend a little bit of money to get it done correctly versus trying to learn it yourself. That would be my advice to someone that's just getting started.
I think going off of what Stephanie said about not being a perfectionist, yes, definitely get it out there before it's perfect. I redid my original flavor, I think, 3 times. Went through 3 different wrappers until I finally got the one that I wanted. And so the customers just had to deal with all these changes, and you know, they'd give us their advice or their recommendations. But I think my advice to you would be, don't get so personally attached to the product or to the business. I mean, of course you need to be passionate about it, but let's say, you know, I launched my, you know, I'm just gonna use this as an example, my coconut cashew bar, we launched it. I loved it, launched it, put it out there, got some feedback from people. And if, you know, I was just so attached to the recipe that I refused to change it, even though I was getting all these recommendations and people saying like, you know, you should really change. I don't like, it's too sweet, it's too whatever, then you'd never grow. So being able to detach yourself from your business and listening to your customers and finding out what you need to change and then doing it, you know, implementing those changes, I think that will be a great asset for you.
I'd like to step in if I may. My advice comes from the dual hat that I wear as a business owner, but also as a person who works to help minority and women-owned businesses and entrepreneurs. My advice is this: use your resources to grow your business. There is already an entrepreneurial ecosystem out there. They know what obstacles you face, they know what you're up against, and they're there because they have a solution for you. And a lot of times in helping you overcome those challenges, they're able to help you at no or low cost to yourself. So, you know, somebody said you need to pay for professional and technical support, and you do. But there are also instances where you're able to get that support and it's not a burden on your business or on your cash flow. So, you know, I'm in this dual hat because really I want people to learn from my mistakes. I felt like we learned the hard way on so many things, only for people to come out of the woodwork afterwards. Oh, we could have told you that. Well, why didn't you? It's too late now. You know, we've already had the negative impact behind it. So if I can help somebody avoid those mistakes, do it right the first time to understand why you need to put out a little bit more money or a little bit more energy to put a system in place that's going to save you heartache and time later, then that's what I want to do, because I wish that somebody had done it for me. So on that note, I'd also like to say that, you know, working at the University of Toledo, I have an incubation program where we bring in businesses and they are able to take advantage of low rent and other resources that the university provides. And I also work with the state on an MBAC program, Minority Business Assistance, where we give coaching advice and we help to make people aware of all the resources that the state offers for free. A lot of it is in the access to capital realm. So please feel free to reach out to me. I would love to talk to you, and I'm always available. Okay, I think I have to popcorn now. All right, I am going to popcorn to Allison.
Oh, I just went. So how about Stacy?
Okay, I feel like a lot of the things that down for my advice for someone starting out is just very similar to what a lot of you have already said. I think that, you know, we talked about the obstacles kind of being in of the business and access to capital and some of the discrimination we face as women. And I think that, you know, if you have an idea for a business, you know, you just make sure it's something that you're really passionate about, because that passion is what's going to give you the energy to keep going day after day after you fall on your face, which is inevitable. And, you know, whether it's, you know, something bigger than your business, or whether it's, you know, the core of your business, or if it's your business team or your community, it doesn't have to necessarily be the thing that you're making or doing, but something in that, you know, you have to really love. And I guess another motto that has kind of helped through this for me has been, where there's a will, there's a way. And I guess, you know, Jara was talking, first the feedback was, you know, having faith. And I think that, you know, entrepreneurs are a special group of people where we just create the things that our community, that makes us unique, and the things that identify our place. And I think, you know, working with other women can be really empowering to find your people who can help you think positive and find those solutions to keep you moving forward.
Thank you, everyone, for such lovely advice and for your time. I really feel, I don't have a business, but I feel really uplifted and I kind of want to start one. But Danielle has a special announcement for our attendees. Do you want to take it away?
Thanks, Ahana. So we are going to, Ahana had a great idea of not only inviting, this was all her idea. Can we give it up for Ahana? Ahana had a great idea of not only inviting these folks in, but also supporting the local businesses. And so we have some gift cards to House of Dow, Jara's Heavenly Sweets, and Bucci Mamas, as well as the three flavors of Cure Bars that we could find here in Toledo. And I think there's three, I think I saw on your, okay, perfect. So all of the flavors. And so after we log up, we'll email you a survey just to see kind of what you got from this. I've also taken down, you know, who was here attendee wise. So you get like one entry for being attendance and one for filling out the survey. So we will pull that tomorrow. We'll give you some time. And thank you all so, so much. I also, you know, am feeling very empowered to, you know, I have the knowledge if I ever wanted to start a business. So thank you all again. Thank you, Ahana, for putting together a fabulous event. And have a great night, y'all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks
you.
So
thank
much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you
stay
for
safe,
having me.
Stay well, stay happy. Love you all.